So hello everyone and thanks for watching. My name is Jesper Andersen and I'm head of the Tonmeister program at the Royal Danish Academy of Music in Copenhagen. So that means that I'm a teacher of sound engineering and music production. And next to that, I'm also associated with the Aalborg University as a PhD fellow in music sound for cochlear implants, distance learning and also 3D audio. But it's quite relevant that I'm here now because I've also been very much involved with developing and managing the distance learning activities at the Royal Danish Academy of Music, and I would like to share some of those experiences with you here now. And I'm presenting here from home in my living room in Copenhagen. I would much rather have been in Melbourne to meet all of you, but yeah, we'll get the best out of this as we can, and then I hope to see some of you on Thursday 14th for an online conversation. So, as I already said, I'm from the Royal Danish Academy of Music in Copenhagen, which was founded in 1867, and it's now the oldest and largest music academy in Denmark with approximately 400 students. Since 2008, we have been located in the building that used to house the Danish broadcast, and our facilities include several concert halls, recording studios, and of course rooms for teaching, practicing, and administration. In this presentation, I would like to share some of the experiences our academy has had with synchronous distance learning, that is, masterclasses and other forms of teaching via video conferencing, an area that we started working on in 2011. This presentation was outlined as far back as November 2019, at a time when no one had imagined this corona situation. So now in the spring of 2020, distance learning has suddenly become a very hot topic. And I would like to include a bit more information about distance learning home setups than I had originally planned. The points and opinions I'm expressing here comes out of a lot of practical experience with over 800 synchronous online events. But this talk is also based on research that our academy has conducted in cooperation with Aalborg University, the Cleveland Institute of Music, and the New World Symphony in Miami Beach. I would like to split the talk into three topics: technologies, didactics, and organization. Starting with the topic of technologies, I would like to give an overview of the systems most commonly used for synchronous distance learning in higher music education. Thereafter, I'll give some short general tips for audio, video, and network. The systems to be used for the highest standard of global video conferencing will not work at all, or at least not perform optimally on a standard commercial internet connection. To get the most out of these systems, you will have to be connected to the International Network for Research and Education. In Australia, this network is called AARNet, it is SHIANT in Europe, Internet 2 in the US, and CERNET in China. Besides the internet connection and the hardware, there's also a task in configuring the local network setup so everything runs smoothly. Depending on the expertise of your local IT department, this might be a task that requires external consulting. The most widely spread system for synchronous distance learning is PolyCom. Many music academies internationally use this system. And since connecting from one PolyCom to another is easy and user-friendly, it seems that everyone stays with this standard. If you connect from one PolyCom to another, you can achieve quite a good audio and video quality, where if you mix several brands or standards, the user-friendliness and technical quality usually suffers. Also, PolyCom is popular because of its live music mode, which was developed in cooperation with the Manhattan School of Music and the Canada National Arts Center. With music mode, the PolyCom will deliver an audio quality which is quite good in terms of dynamic range and frequency range, even though the sound is still quite far from CD quality. PolyCom also delivers a desktop version that can run locally on a PC, but that system will not deliver the same audio quality as the hardware systems. There are also similar hardware systems that can deliver video conferencing in quite good quality. They include systems from Cisco, Tanberg, Lifesize, Avaya, and many others, but they are not widely spread in higher music education. It's important to note that even though these systems are powerful and of the highest standard, there's still a delay in the connection. The delay is usually somewhere between half a second and a whole second. This means that playing together is not possible. For some teachers, this delay is very disturbing. Others are not so affected by it, depending on their teaching method. To achieve a connection fast enough to play together, the delay will have to be as low as around 30 milliseconds, or 1/30th of a second. That is the delay which is the equivalent of the speed of sound over 7 meters, which is something that a musician can experience on stage and can actually be a natural performance situation. Once the delay gets longer than these 30 milliseconds, musicians will feel a lag in the connection and playing together starts to become difficult. Currently, there is one standard system that will support such a fast connection, and that is the LoLa system developed by the Music Academy in Trieste with the Italian National Consortium for Research and Education Networks, GAR. LoLa is a free software that will run on a specially configured and powerful Windows PC. Connecting within a distance of 2,000 kilometers, the delay can be short enough that musicians can play together. However, live performance can still be problematic due to the limited sense of presence that microphones, loudspeakers, cameras, and screens can provide. It's worth mentioning that even with the fastest network and computers, it will never be possible to play together, for instance, here from Copenhagen to Melbourne. Even with one long cable going straight from here to there and the signal traveling with the speed of light, it will still take 53 milliseconds for the signal to arrive over the 16,000 kilometers. So, to play together between Copenhagen and Melbourne would require us to transmit the signal faster than the speed of light, and that is something that is not just around the corner. Alternatively, it would of course be possible to work with alternative music, where precise timing is not so important. Presenting low latency systems, it's worth mentioning the software-based Ultragrid and the hardware-based MVTP, both developed at CISNET, which is the National Research and Education Network in the Czech Republic. Also, the Nimbra, developed in Sweden, deserves a mention. These systems can provide a very low latency, but usually not quite as low as LoLa. Moving on to general tips recording audio, video and network. In these days of isolation, I would like to split this talk into two parts. First, some reflections on institutional setups, and secondly, which is very relevant these days, some thoughts on home setups. Besides getting a good network connection, the most important piece of advice for institutions who want to work with distance learning is that they should get a dedicated room for this. Many places where distance learning equipment is mobile or installed in a room used for other purposes, coordinating activities can be very difficult and limiting to the potential. And planning is difficult enough to start with, since you're dealing with cross-institutional planning, many times also across different time zones. In addition to that, there will also be a need to use the facilities for testing and tryouts, and it will save a lot of technical manpower if the equipment can be left set up between sessions. In a permanent distance learning studio, there are also better possibilities for having a good video light system mounted, and good light conditions will improve the picture quality dramatically. The rest of the technical setup in a distance learning studio will be similar to that of a simple television studio with professional microphones and so on. The actual setup of microphones and camera will vary a lot from instrument to instrument, and it will be too much to go into the details of that now. But it is important to note that the setup should be adjusted from session to session to ensure that it will support the teaching situation as good as possible. You can probably imagine that the setup for a cello session is quite different from the setup for a piano session. For home connections, it is always advised to get a fast internet connection that is also cabled. The quality of the network can often have a greater impact on the technical quality than your microphones and cameras. If a home network is very bad, which is sometimes the case, you could consider disabling the video to prioritize the bandwidth for audio. Or, in some cases, it's a good idea to shift to a teaching method where students will upload a recording of themselves and the teacher can give feedback live online. Many teachers even report that this approach has some advantages, since the students will have to prepare a finished performance for feedback rather than showing up for a more casual one-on-one lesson, and this can sometimes improve the focus and the learning outcome. Also, you could consider switching to streaming via YouTube or similar platforms that will provide a much better audio quality. The delay in these systems can be over 10 seconds. But performing here should be fine, and then you can move to standard video conferencing for feedback and conversation. From home, it is very hard to achieve a sound good enough for optimal instrumental teaching, but there are ways of getting pretty far with the sound. First of all, at least one of the participants should wear headphones. This will minimize the sound leaking from one side to the other and thereby lowering the impact of the audio gating and echo cancel algorithms that all these systems work with. It also helps if all participants make sure to mute their microphones when they're not talking. It's good to have an external microphone and also an external webcam. This will enable you to place the two independently, since the best placement of a microphone is probably not the best place for the camera. At least you will need an external microphone, but then you could work with a built-in camera in a laptop, for instance. The most expensive top professional microphones can cost the same as a quite nice car, but for home video conferencing, a good USB microphone costing around 120 euros will do very well. The placement of the microphone has a much larger impact on the audio quality than the microphone itself in these situations. For playing, usually the microphone should be at a larger distance than from talking. It's very important to do a sound check and make sure that everything is optimized and that the sound is not distorting. The audio quality of most of the systems used for home video conferencing, like Skype, FaceTime, Teams, Big Blue Button, Blue Jeans, Meet, and others, the sound quality of those is quite similar. But here, the Zoom platform deserves a special mention, since it has some extra functions that will allow a higher audio resolution, and it is probably the home system with the best chances of providing successful distance learning teaching from a home network. Usually, webcams will give quite a good video quality, especially under good light conditions. You may have to add a lamp to get properly lit, and if there's a window in the room, make sure that you're facing it. Other than that, always take care that the framing of the picture is supporting the situation you are in. Some video conferencing systems will even allow you to have several cameras connected simultaneously, so you can switch between them. Now, I would like to move from the technical advice to talk about how the teaching situation changes when it is moved to video conferencing. In general, it's fair to say that almost everyone agrees that being together in the same room is always better, even though there can be some advantages to distance learning, also didactic advantages. The effectiveness and experience of distance learning varies a lot from instrument to instrument. Lessons for instruments like guitar and cello translate very well, while other instruments like piano, organ, and also singing is more difficult. Teachers also respond very differently, and it's important to point out that it is not necessarily young teachers that likes distance learning and old teachers that does not. There's a strong tendency that the teachers are more affected by the limitations of distance learning than the students are. Some approaches to teaching will not work very well, and besides the limited technical quality, it's a great restraint that the teacher cannot walk around the student or sit side by side. There's a strong tendency that the teaching will become more verbalized and have a stronger focus on interpretation, expression, and the historical background of a piece. This means that the lessons also become more verbalized, and if there is a language barrier, it will become more apparent. Also, many teachers and students point out that distance learning sessions are quite tiring, and this should be taken into consideration when planning these activities. Other research findings and practical experiences can be summed up in these six headlines. 1. Students are more active and they reflect deeper. Especially students, but also teachers, report that since students are left more to finding their own solutions to technical problems, their learning is embodied in themselves to a higher extent, which increases their learning outcome. 2. Visual impression plays a new role. Mostly the teacher will sense that the visual possibilities are limited, but the technologies can also be put to good use, for instance by using multiple cameras that will allow the teacher to see an extreme close-up of fingerings, for instance, while seeing the full body posture of the student at the same time. So teachers should be very concerned and very picky about the picture quality that they are receiving. 3. The teaching room plays a new role. In standard teaching, there's usually a feeling that the student is visiting the teacher in the teacher's room. But in telepresence, everyone are visitors. This can, for instance, affect the sensation of hierarchy and other forms of personal relations that many times has to be established, for instance, through small talk. 4. New teaching forms can be developed. These technical possibilities for networking and the fact that you can connect seamlessly to everyone globally really invites to develop and share new forms of teaching and knowledge sharing. For instance, it's possible for a small instrument group or a small professional network to connect to peers internationally. 5. A higher focus on teaching method is introduced. Since the teaching situation is affected and sometimes has to be rethought, this can raise a new focus on teaching methods. Suddenly, teachers are more aware what they are doing when they are teaching, and we have seen several occasions where this has led to really interesting discussions. 6. The engineer is affecting the teaching situation. Finally, it's worth mentioning that some students and teachers can be affected by the fact that there's an engineer in the room. The session is not private. In some cases, we have sessions where the engineer will be there to start up and leave when everything is up and running. But usually the engineer will have to be there to optimize the sound and video continuously throughout the session. It's important to have an engineer who really understands the teaching situation and also is good at welcoming the students and teachers to help them feel comfortable with the whole situation. Rounding off this presentation, I would like to describe how the distance learning activities are organized here at the Royal Danish Academy of Music. It seems like the institutional grounding of distance learning is really one of the keys to success, and many institutions find that this is actually more difficult than overcoming the technical and didactic challenges. So, this little third chapter in my presentation is meant as a look into our organization, which might inspire others to do the same, or, depending on your institution, do something very different. At our academy, the distance learning department is based in the international office. It could have been a choice to base it in the department that arranges masterclasses or at the broader study administration. But we chose to say that the distance learning is a tool for international outreach, and this has worked very well since we continuously can develop the distance learning activities so they match the international work. For instance, if a teacher is traveling to do guest teaching at a partner institution, it's obvious to see if the value of such a visit can be greatly enhanced with a few resources by adding one or more distance learning sessions. We have also had good experiences of arranging online revisits from guest teachers who have been to Copenhagen, and then they are able to follow up with our students. The activities are managed by Marianne Jacobsen, who is our head at the international office, and me, who works with music technology. It's really a merge of internationalization and technology. Every year, before the summer holiday, we will go through all previous activities and make a large idea catalog of relevant sessions for each relevant teacher. Here we can also aim to involve new areas and new partner institutions. From there, the teacher chooses which activities they would like to focus on, and then the detailed planning can start. We usually start with an idea list of around 200 sessions and end up with around 100 being conducted during the academic year. This approach requires good contact to all teachers, since coordinating sessions can be quite difficult and teachers tend to respond slow to emails with the word distance learning in the topic. To our experience, this is not due to lack of interest or enthusiasm, but really it reflects that our teachers are very busy and they need to prioritize their everyday work. Usually, a session will consist of our teacher teaching 2 hours to the other institution and their teacher will give a 2-hour session back to us, but other cooperations can also take place. So wrapping up now, I would like to say that it has been a pleasure professionally, personally, and also for our institution to work with distance learning technology. And we have a very good and very strong international network with a good tradition for helping each other out. And this network is partly based around the Network Performing Arts Production Workshop Group. So I strongly suggest that you check that out. And then also in the spirit of knowledge sharing, I would like to share my email address and encourage anyone with the comments and questions in the area of distance learning technology to contact me. Other than that, I just want to say thanks a lot for your attention, and I hope to be able to meet with all of you sometime out there in the real life in person. Thanks for watching.